Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Science Thursday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a closer look at hydrocarbon fuel cell. Not hydrogen fuel cell, but hydrocarbon one. So let's dive right into it. So before we go any deeper, we have to understand what the heck is a fuel cell. Now, many of you know, all the energy that you have in your petrol, diesel, LNG or LPG is basically chemical energy. Now, we sometimes want to get electricity out of it, sometimes we want mechanical energy out of it. So when you put your petrol into, you know, basically generator, it converts that chemical energy into mechanical energy, then that mechanical energy is converted back to electrical. So you have an extra step if you need electricity. Now, of course, if you need direct locomotion, as in terms of a car or a truck, you don't do this step, you simply go from chemical energy to physical motion. Now, fuel cell is inherently different in this regard. What it does is basically takes chemical energy and turns it into electricity. Now, it has very simple, it's more or less like a battery, but it's you can think of it as an active battery. Instead of charging it with electricity, you charge it with fuel and oxygen. Be mindful, it cannot be completely sealed. The sole reason we can even use this in space is simply you have a completely sealed off oxygen supply, liquid oxygen sometimes, and liquid hydrogen. So it needs its own basically supply. It's not something that you can just put fuel in, magically it will give, you know, electricity. It must also have air intake. So in this regard, it's different. So if you build a car out of it, you have to make sure it has enough airflow to go into them. And it's more or less like a battery. It operates on a more or less same principle. Now, the tricky part about it, the reason why we are so interested in it, is the efficiency. Now, many of you know, internal combustion engines can barely max 30% efficiency, barely. Now, of course, there are some designs that can reach 40%, but problem is those designs cost so much that nobody mass produces them. So 20% to 30% is generally agreed upon. It's like that's your end, like from tank to wheel efficiency, from your chemical energy from your fuel tank to your wheel. Now this goes upward easily. You can buy a fuel cell right now that gives you 40% efficiency, and some are at 60%. Now, so that way, if you have hydrogen based car, it still has some significant advantage simply because it's so efficient. Now, on top of that, it also gives off heat. Now, you might be like, okay, engine also gives off heat. Yes, and nowadays we are using what we call cogeneration. So that heat can be used. So if you use that heat plus the electrical energy, because electrical energy is directly created, you can get upwards of 80 to 90% efficiency. Now, be mindful, this technology is nothing new. This technology has been with us for 1838. So suffice to say, it's kind of old technology. Like, people make it in their school. These sort of cells are used in space technology. You can buy cars that have fuel cell. So this is fuel cell itself. So let's understand the aspect of fuel. So fuel, most fuel cell what we have, it's called proton exchange membrane. Basically, many of you remember, we have electron, we have neutron, we have proton. Now, neutron has no charge in it, but electron does. Now, proton exchange membrane allows us to, you know, transfer protons and then get our electricity out of it. Now, that prefers clean hydrogen. When I mean clean hydrogen, I actually mean that term. You cannot have a hydrogen going into your system where it's like, you know, it's 98% hydrogen, 2% extra stuff. It will not work very effectively and it will lose efficiency, and not to mention it will degrade the life of the cell. For that reason, the hydrogen that is used for fuel cell purposes are generally cleaned up to very large extent. Like, you want to make sure that it is as close to 100% as possible. That's why it needs clean hydrogen. You can't have hydrogen like, you know, okay, it's 99% hydrogen but 1% impurities. It will shorten the lifespan of the cell. Then we come to the most interesting fuel nowadays, is methane. Now, as many of you know, I have already made the fall of hydrogen economy. Is the simplest problem with hydrogen is that it's not dense. That's it. Like, at the end of the day, density matters, specifically if you are living, you know, on Earth, because size matters. Density will directly correspond to your size, and mass also. So if you have 1 liter of hydrogen, it cannot compete with 1 liter of kerosene or diesel. It just cannot. You need 11 liter of hydrogen to compete with that. And not to mention that liter I'm talking about, it's more or less ultra high pressure, as in 700 psi or liquefied stage, which is cryogenic and ludicrously expensive. So all things considered, for that reason alone, hydrogen is not a good fuel. In my video, you you can go into the details of it. Now, methane uses carbon as a bonding agent, where you have carbon bonded with four hydrogen. So that way you can get a much higher density. Now, more carbon you add, the more solid that things become. So that's why if you have low carbon, you get basically methane. You get very large amount of carbon, you get coal. So that's the gradient. So you go down, as you go down, you go to liquid like ethanol. You go down, you add more carbon, you go down to coal. So for this reason, we want to use some hydrocarbon. This is the whole point of this video. Hydrogen is not a good fuel. On the other hand, hydrocarbon is awesome. Now, methane is our attractive fuel source for now. Then many fuel cells can also use natural gas, which is more or less methane itself, but it's only 70-80% methane. It also has other components of butane and propane, things of that nature. Then we come to the liquid fuel aspect of making it run on ethanol. This is very interesting. If this works successfully, as in it does work successfully right now, you can buy it. It's just, I'm talking about cost term analysis. It can be made from corn, soya, or you can check my episode on LG biofuel. So you can have a complete economy running on these sort of thing based on fuel cell. If you can make sure the fuel cell runs on hydrocarbon, specifically heavy hydrocarbon, in which case ethanol to diesel. If we can get to diesel, we are set. So this is the aspect of the fuel. Now, this whole technology is even possible simply because of solid oxidized fuel cell. Now, all you have to understand it is this is more like a fire, because it is a very high temperature device. I'm not talking 100 degrees Celsius. This can easily go upwards of 500 to 1000 degrees Celsius. Some even works at higher temperature. Each temperature has its own advantage. Like higher temperature, one can handle diesel. Lower temperature, one can give you higher efficiency, but it will require methane. So there is a balancing act here. Now, the scientific community on this matter is completely divided. Some prefer let's make it very efficient, so we can, even with methane is low density compared to diesel, so people do not want to use that. However, be mindful, even this fuel cell, it is actually working solely on hydrogen. Now, it is extracting the hydrogen from hydrocarbon. That's the tricky aspect of it. It's not working like where it's a complete fuel cell, that where you are giving it, hydrogen. So it's still working on hydrogen. Be mindful and be aware of that. It's not using carbon. Carbon to it is just a basically binding material. So, and because of the solid oxide nature, it can exceed the efficiency of 50%. You can easily achieve 60% efficiency, as in if you buy a cell today, it gives you 60% efficiency. Now, US military has also started investing a lot of in that, and they have this sort of design where you have fuel coming in. It goes through what we call reforming. Reforming is basically mixing it with very high temperature steam. That steam basically breaks the hydrogen and carbon. So all you get is like H2NCO, carbon monoxide, and then it goes to the fuel cell. So this is the whole aspect of a solid oxide fuel cell. It internally does this sort of thing. So that reforming, you don't have to do reforming. Of course, you have to preheat it. Generally, all the solid oxide fuel cell generally have what we call preheater. So you don't want your fuel to come in that is 0 degrees Celsius. You want your fuel to be as close to your operational temperature, which can be as high as 500 degrees Celsius. So this is the whole technology. This is what we are talking about. We are not talking about protein exchange membrane. We are talking about solid oxide fuel, because it can use hydrocarbon and it uses reforming to get that hydrogen that actually does the work. So what are the pros of this? First, it has almost no moving parts. As many of you know who have worked with cars and engines, they have hundreds of moving parts just in the engine. Let's not even go to transmission and gearbox and other things. It's a lot of moving parts. Now this, on the other hand, has little to no moving part. Now, of course, there would be fans to make sure the air intake is always at pressurized, and preheaters. There are some moving components. It's not 100% absolutely static. You can build them, but it will be very low. To increase the power density, we generally have compressed air, preheated fuel for that reason. So it inherently has very little to no moving parts, so which also means it's very quiet. So you can have one fuel cell generator running next to you, you won't even hear it. And the fact it can use hydrocarbon, as hydrocarbon is the best fuel source that we have. So Now, to give you a context of it, why would anybody even want to, you know, do this if you are only going to use hydrocarbon? Like, let's say if you are running your car on petrol compared, then why the hell bother? Simple. Petrol car at best case scenario can give you 30% efficiency, and in real life it's even less than that. This can easily exceed 60%. Some that works on natural gas can even achieve 70%, and have achieved it, as in like 78% is at true efficiency. Then by the time you get electrical energy to run your motors, you can easily achieve 70% efficiency. So given with the same amount of carbon dioxide released to the atmosphere, you're still getting more work done. And for a generator set, basically if you want to use it for power generation, this has multiple advantage. Now many many of you are aware of what we call cogeneration, basically where you get your energy but you also use the waste heat. Now many times it's generally very popular among people who are living in colder climate, where they have generator unit doing the power generation, and the heat from it is used as a cool down. That heat is basically used to heat up the living area. Basically district heating, central heating, things of that nature can be done. And if you're like living in a hot environment like India, where the coldest temperature is like 10 degrees Celsius, if you're lucky. Now, hot temperature does go up towards 60 degrees Celsius. 52 I have already seen. So in that sort of scenario, you might be like, okay, what the hell I'm gonna do with that heat? That heat can be used by the method what we call absorption chiller, where that heat itself acts as a compressor energy. Basically, you have energy into your compressor that does the movement. Here, that heat itself will act and does the refrigeration. So you can get very high efficiency in practical sense. Like, it's useful energy I'm talking about. I'm not talking about like, okay, it has this efficiency but you will lose. I'm talking useful energy. It's from chemical energy to your useful power, you can easily achieve 80%+ easily if you have cogeneration. So these are the pro aspect of it. And nowadays this company has caught my eye because they are building fuel cell that is basically stainless steel, but they are using laser technology to etch it such a way that it doesn't melt from that temperature, and allows much more surface area for ion transmission and things of that nature. And it can work on upwards of butane. So I don't think it can work on liquid fuel. They haven't provided any information on that, but they do mention it time and time again. It can work on natural gas or basically LPG. So these are the pro of it. Now there must be some consequences, and this is the Nissan car that also uses this. So yes, you can make a vehicle out of it. The consequence of this is like, there hasn't been this technology, the solid oxide system, it's not new. That also is like 20-30 years old, but it hasn't reached large scale production, and it's not cost competitive yet because it hasn't reached large scale production. Now all things considered, even then you might be like, okay, it will be solved in the future, but again, this is like always few years away. Like this guy, he's an Indian, worked in NASA, and NASA also builds their fuel cell, but he inverted that fuel cell. Instead of getting oxygen, he started putting in oxygen and getting electricity out of it. So he made this Boom Energy company that you can see, but website is online, but no other information is there. And this is from 2010. Then we have this Redox that came just 2 years after this Boombox. It came and it was like, this is a generator unit which is like 25 kilowatt. It's the size of a human, like that size, if you are not able to guess, it's just my height, basically 5 feet tall. So there are many, many companies, if you look around, that were like, betting their money on solid oxide fuel system, but none of them to this day has come into, front phase and like, large scale mass production. So this does offer up some legit criticism, because this fuel cell was costing upwards of $10,000 per kilowatt. This is supposed to be around $800 per kilowatt. And if those numbers sound very huge, you must understand this. This is hundreds of times more expensive than solar panels. So you can check my video about solar here also. So it always is like, it's just few years we're gonna have mass production. Just few years we're gonna have mass production. This is just few gonna year we're gonna use this as a main power generation, because it does have advantage. Let's say instead of transmitting power that is, you are generating from burning natural gas, directly burn the natural gas next to your city and get the energy. That way you reduce transmission loss, and you get extra benefits also from this because it is more efficient. So all things considered, every time I'm researching this is always coming up the same thing, like 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 12 years ago, but nothing concrete that I can show you. Okay, this company is CS Power. I'm hoping that it doesn't turn out to be any of these two companies. Heck, this company's website is also not active right now. So these are the consequences of this. Like, I haven't seen anyone actually turning this idea from small scale to actual large scale manufacturing. So this was my presentation on hydrocarbon fuel cell. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like, share it amongst your friends, and subscribe. And I would urge you to leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Science Thursday. If you're free, press the bell icon. And as always, thanks for watching.